All right, tonight we look at the doctrine of baptism. Before we jump into baptism, let's remind ourselves tonight what the sacraments are. We looked last time at the means of grace. There are two means of grace. It's the preaching of the gospel, which is the chief means of grace, and God has given along with that preaching the sacraments. What are sacraments again? What are sacraments, Kurt? Okay, they're signs, and what else are they? Alex?
Seals.
Seals. So a sign, which is something visible, picturing an invisible grace, and then a seal. What's a seal? Corey, you know what a seal is?
Makes true the righteousness of Christ.
Okay, good, right. It's something that shows that it's genuine, it's true. It's true for me, and what's true for me is what's pictured in those sacraments, that I'm righteous in Christ, my sins are forgiven. So the sacraments aren't just pictures for us to look at, they're more than that. They're for the strengthening of our faith. God gives the preaching for that as well. He works faith in us by the preaching and strengthens it. But he also gives the sacraments along with it. We talked about the sacraments as the visual aids. The preaching we hear, the sacraments we see, but it's the same message. What's the message of the sacraments that's the same as the preaching? What's the message of the sacraments? Charlie.
To show that salvation is found in Christ.
Salvation is found in Christ alone. We need him. We need him. So that's what the sacrament shows. So we want to keep that in mind tonight, now as we look at the sacrament of baptism. All right, so that's what we're looking at, baptism tonight. Basically, two main things that we want to look at tonight as we look at baptism, but they're found under 3 points. But the first thing we want to look at is the meaning of baptism. And the second thing we want to see, to make sure that we understand that the water of baptism is not what washes away sin. And then the third thing we want to look at is infant baptism. Why do we practice infant baptism here in our church? And we see it often, don't we? We've had many babies, and we want to understand why. But part of understanding why is, okay, we're seeing baptism often. We saw 3 babies baptized this past Sunday. We have 3 more babies that must be baptized. We've had a lot of baptisms already in this year. And part of it is, okay, when the sacrament is administered here in the church, what do we think about? Why is it there? Why is it part of our worship? Is it for that baby? Is it for the parents? Or is it for the entire church? What do you think? Is the sacrament for that baby? Is it for the parents? For the entire church? Tyler, what do you think?
For the whole church to see the washing away of sins.
Yeah, good. It's for the entire church. It's not just for the baby doesn't understand. Usually they're sleeping. One I had puts, you see the hand go up. Try to push my hand away. So that doesn't happen too often. But the baby doesn't understand what's going on. The parents obviously do, but it's not just for them. They make vows, and they're important vows. But it's for the entire church. It's for us to see. So that's why the meaning of baptism is so important, because you've been baptized, and now you get to witness the sacrament of baptism. What does it mean? All right? So, that's the question here. What's the meaning of baptism? Look first at the symbolism. All right? We'll use that as our first main point, the symbolism. Ashley, what does baptism picture?
Washing away sins.
Great. Washing away of our sins. Okay? But along with that, okay, when there's the washing away of sins, what it first of all pictures is entering into the covenant. Okay, so we're going to see that first of all. We'll get to the washing away of sins in a moment. Baptism pictures entering into the covenant. Remember what God's covenant is, the relationship of friendship. Okay, you've had that filled into your heads, you know that. If I ask you what covenant's about, you know it's about that. A relationship of friendship that God gives to us. It's a relationship of friendship between God and his people. If you don't know it yet, you may write it. certainly don't have to, just a reminder there. But the point we want to see here in baptism is that it's by the blood of Jesus Christ that we have the legal right to have friendship with God. And that's what baptism shows to us. We enter into the covenant of God only through the blood of Christ. Only through Jesus Christ. And that's a really important point. We're going to see the connection to infant baptism later on. But it's a really important point because there are a lot of people today who say, no, it's because I made a decision, I made a choice, I accepted Jesus Christ, I prayed the sinner's prayer, and because of that, I enter into a relationship with God. No, it's not at all that. We enter in because God has done something. He's taking care of our sins, and that means I can have friendship and fellowship with Him. And that means babies can be part of that too. So baptism pictures entering into the covenant of God. And the idea is that sin must be removed in order to have fellowship with God. And Christ's blood and Christ's Spirit are what do that. So this leads right into that point that Ashley made when she said, and rightly so, that baptism represents, it pictures the washing away of sin. So here's the question. Whenever you see the sacrament of baptism administered, you know that water is involved. Okay? So water is sprinkled on the head of the baby that is baptized. What's that water a picture of? What is the water a picture of? Elsa.
Christ's blood.
Okay, Christ's blood. Is it a picture of anything else? We always get that one. We know that water is a picture of Christ's blood. Is it a picture of anything else? Not sure. All right. Well, we'll come to it in a second. It pictures Christ's blood. So, when a baby is baptized with that water, and you all have been baptized with that water, it's a picture of a reality that happens with Christ's blood. What does it mean that Christ's blood washes away sin? What does that mean? Yes. Ashley.
Our sin.
Okay, good. Now you have different parts of sin, right? What are the different parts of sin? Let's look at that. What are the different parts of sin? Ben, what's sin?
Disobedience to God's law.
Okay, it's disobedience. So there's that. So does Christ's blood wash away my disobedience? That would be kind of a strange way to say it, wouldn't it? It doesn't wash away my disobedience. What does it wash away? Jory?
Punishment.
So for my sin, for my disobedience, I deserve punishment. And the blood of Jesus Christ takes care of that punishment. So that's the first thing we want to see. First of all, notice the water pictures Christ's blood. And what that blood does is it takes away the guilt and the punishment of sin. So there, first of all, is the important thing to think about as we see baptism administered. It's a picture for me who's watching that. For all of you who's watching it. Do I know, do I believe that what's pictured there is true for me? Remember, sign and seal. It's a picture to strengthen my faith. That's why God's given it. So is my faith strengthened when I see it? The idea is, the more we see it, what a blessing it is for the church, because the more we're reminded that with that picture, our sins, the punishment, is washed away. Why? Well, Jesus Christ took that punishment when he died on the cross of Calvary. His blood was shed. So that I can have that. Wonderful. Comforting. Strengthening of our faith. Okay? So that's the first thing. Now, what else does that water baptism picture? Anybody think more about it? Let's turn to Titus chapter 3. Titus 3, verse 5. Titus 3, verse 5. Levi, would you read that, please?
Now by works of righteousness, which we have done, according to his mercy, he has saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost.
Okay, so there it talks about washing. Do you see anything from that passage that would tell us that the water pictures something else beside the blood of Jesus Christ? Jordan?
Regeneration.
Close. Erica? The Holy Spirit. Okay? The water of baptism is also a picture of the Holy Spirit. What does the Holy Spirit do? What does the Holy Spirit do? You said regeneration, right? Well, when he regenerates, what else does he do? What else does he do? Remember the name Holy? So what would that indicate about his work in us? Sanctification. Okay? So this is the part we often miss and we forget, and we're forgetting half the sacrament then. Water pictures the Spirit's work of removing the pollution of our sins. And that's part of the point of Titus 3 verse 5, washing, washing. When your clothes get dirty, I realize that many of you probably don't do your own laundry, but they need to be washed, right? You don't just throw them in a basket and miraculously they're washed. They need to go through the washing machine to be washed. Well, that's basically what the Holy Spirit is doing to us. He's washing us. He's doing it through our lives, changing us so that more and more we're getting rid of the dirt of our sin and we're living in obedience to Him. Baptism is a picture of that. It's a picture really of a complete saving work of God. Not just Jesus who pays for my sins. That's important. We need that, of course. But also, I need this washing. And so that's what's assured, how we're assured. We're assured that all of our sins are being washed away by the work of the Holy Spirit. So that gives us encouragement in the battle against sin in our lives. Remember I said Sunday night, talked about that last night a little bit, that when we fight against sin, we strangle it. And when we strangle it, fights. Our old man of sin fights. It doesn't like it. And so that's what happens in our own lives. We're fighting against something that's fighting against us. But we have strength, not in ourselves. I can't do it myself. Through the Holy Spirit, who works by His Word, and also by the sacrament. So remember that symbolism. Water, the water of baptism pictures what two things, Nate? Christ's blood and His Spirit. Christ's blood and His Spirit. Drill that into your head. Christ's blood and Spirit. Underline those two things. You see they're bold here. And then you remember, this is what baptism pictures. Those two things. Now, this is the way that I enter into the covenant of God. It's only through Jesus Christ and the work of His Spirit. All right, secondly, along with that, we want to understand the connection between the sign and the reality. And here's what I mean by that. What I mean by that is that the water in baptism doesn't do anything. You know who believes that the water in baptism actually does something? Jory? Roman Catholics. Okay? That's what they believe about their sacraments, that the physical sign actually does something spiritually. Well, remember our definition of sacraments. A sign, which is a visible picture of an invisible grace. All right, so it doesn't tell us that it actually does something. But what it does is it seals, it strengthens our faith. It doesn't actually wash away sins. It doesn't actually do a saving work on us. Roman Catholics believe the sacraments do that. That's not what baptism does. And so we want to understand it from that negative point of view. Sprinkling with water at baptism is a sign pointing to an invisible reality. When those three babies were baptized yesterday, nothing changed for them. They didn't all of a sudden get regenerated. They didn't all of a sudden get saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. It's a sign and a seal. A sign and a seal. And one day when they're older, they understand it. It's going to be a sign and a seal for them too. Romans 6 points this out. Let's turn to Romans 6 a minute. Romans 6 is such an important passage in regard to baptism. and showing the connection between what's pictured and the reality. Romans 6, verses 3 through 6, Nate, Jory, Erica, and Ashley, would you read those?
Know ye not that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death?
Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ is raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
Knowing this, that an old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin.
Okay. So what's being distinguished here is that there's a real baptism in Christ. There's a real baptism in Christ. Real baptism, well, from the perspective of water sprinkled on your head, that's not the real thing. That's the picture. But that picture is something very real that happens in the hearts and lives of God's people. And that is, their sins are washed away, the punishment of their sin and the corruption of their sin. And Romans 6 is emphasizing, especially that second part, that pollution is being washed away, the corruption of our sin. So we are changed. We walk in newness of life. So here's the question for you. It's not only important this, have you been baptized with water? But the important question is, have you been baptized with Christ? Have you been buried with him? Have you been baptized into him? Do you know that his blood has washed away your sins? Do you know that the Holy Spirit is working in you right now, changing you? Or, if not, then what's happening is you don't know that and you don't care much about it. And what's happening is that you're just living how you want and you're not doing what God calls you to do. That's how important it is. So the picture points us to the reality. It's not just, did you get some water sprinkled on your head? But you have the reality of that. Now you can't make yourself have the reality of that. That's the gift of God. And that's what baptism then works. For believers, it strengthens their faith and assures them of that reality. That's the point we want to see here. All right, just as water washes in this life, so Jesus' blood and the Holy Spirit wash away sin. That's the reality. And sometimes we might think, and here's just the practical comfort of it, we might think, my sin's too great. God couldn't possibly forgive that. Or, I've done it again and again, God wouldn't possibly forgive that. Or, I can't get rid of this sin. Baptism is there to assure us, yes, God changes us, and he does wash away sin in the blood of Christ. And this is a seal that assures us then that our sins are washed away. And that goes along with this next point, and point number two there. This only takes place for the elect child of God. That everyone who is baptized with water has the reality that's pictured. Only the elect. But those elect come to have the assurance of it. They come to have that assurance that their sins are being washed away. There's a couple practical importance things that I want to bring up with you tonight. The first is this, that you have been baptized with water is a sign, a picture of the uniform that you wear. It's one way to look at it, the uniform that you wear. It tells you what camp you belong to. Think about that from this perspective. Some of you who play sports and the rest of you who observe them and cheer them on and so on who are playing, you know what side you're rooting for and you know what team you're rooting for because of the uniforms that they wear. All right? So you cheer one side on because they're wearing the uniform that belongs to your school that you're cheering for. Or as the basketball tournament comes up and I see some of you wearing sweatshirts that represent the school that you might root for, even though they may not be doing very well right now. We won't call attention to anybody or whatever. We root for them when they're playing. We know what team to root for because of the uniform they wear. All that's the idea here too. What uniform do we wear? Baptism is a uniform, as it were. It tells us what side we're on. It tells us we're on God's side. Why are we on God's side? Because of what He has done. Because of what Jesus Christ has done. Because of what the Holy Spirit has done. So this sign, as you've been baptized, tells you that you belong to God. You belong to Jesus Christ. It's what God says to all those who are His children, His loved people. And so that's the sign. Now, there's importance for parents then. I'll just bring this up real quickly. I realize you're not parents yet, but you have parents, and the Lord willing, one day you will be parents. For parents, it's this. It reminds them they're to teach their children the truth about God. They're to teach their children about the work of Jesus Christ and how to live a godly life. And that's the most important thing that they do in their lives, really. Is teach you about God, teach you what it means to live in relationship to Him. And the third thing is just a couple of things for you. Now, what does that mean for you that you have this uniform? For your parents, it means they teach. For you, it means this. Study and prepare to take an active place in the church. You are baptized because you're born into the church. It's true. Those who are believers, those who understand the reality of this baptism, are going to take an active place in the church. And you have to prepare yourselves for that. You're members of the church by baptism. One day you'll make confession of faith, the Lord willing, and you'll be a member in full communion. So prepare yourself for that. By the way, that's what catechism is for. And that's why we have catechism until you make confession of faith. It's not to force you in some way to make confession of your faith. No, this is an opportunity for you to prepare. All of your catechism instructions from the time you started in first grade till the time you conclude is to prepare you to make confession of your faith so that you can be an active member of the Church of Christ. So you can live out the picture of baptism in your life. Confessing that you believe in Christ, you know the forgiveness of sins, that He's working a change in you, in your life. All right, so we're studying and preparing for that. The second thing is live a life that shows you belong to God. You've been baptized. Simply this, show it. Are you showing your life that you're set apart? You wear this uniform, okay? So if you're on the basketball court, you're wearing a covenant uniform. You're not going to go shoot a basket in the other team's basket, right, Trevor? That would be pretty bad. I think you'd be on the bench. All right? So you don't do it that way. All right? Well, but now just think about that spiritually for a second. Think about it spiritually. What do? That indicates we're at times playing on the wrong team. There's a lot of things we can think of right off the top of our heads. If we're not obeying mom, if we're not respecting our teachers, if we're not working hard, things that come out of our mouths, the way we treat others, what we look at, what we listen to, what we take into our bodies, okay, the list can go on and on. So where is it showing that we're not living by the uniform of baptism? Okay, so it's very practical when we look at this and understand what baptism is. How are we living? Now we get to infant baptism. You are part of the church that practices infant baptism. As we talk about this tonight, it's not the first time you've talked about it. But you had to answer some questions in your next work tonight that dealt with that. Lord's Day 27 of the Heidelberg Catechism. The baptism form, questions 3 and 4 there, I think I assigned you for tonight. Here's why this is important. In our day, there are a lot of churches that don't practice infant baptism. One time, when we were on vacation many, many years ago, for many years, we had gone down to Kentucky to a lake down there. And I found a little, basically it was a Reformed Baptist church. We went there on Sunday, heard a very nice sermon from the man, but I got to talking to him afterwards. I was a pastor at the time, but I've only been a pastor for a few years maybe. But we got talking about baptism, because he was asking what our churches believe in, so I don't remember how, but we got talking about baptism. And he told me that he would practice in his church, if people wanted their infants baptized, he would do that. If they didn't, then he would practice believer baptism. It didn't matter to him. He would do both. That was the first time I'd ever heard of that. I had never come across that before. I was a little surprised by that. Didn't know exactly what to say. Now, there are others who don't practice infant baptism at all. They would say only believer baptism, because in the New Testament, you have examples only of believers being baptized. And also, they would look at our practice and say, well, the reason you baptize your children is because you as parents are believers. So it's about the parents. Because the parents are believers, then you baptize the children. Well, that's not why we baptize our children. That's not accurate. But I've read that argument over and over again by those who often are quite Calvinistic and Reformed in their doctrine, but they still practice believer baptism. And I would say that's a false argument. But now it's up to you to prove that wrong. Why do we baptize our children? Is it because your parents are believers? Is that why they had you baptized? Why do we do it? Corey, any ideas? Where would you start if you had to defend infant baptism to someone who believed in believer baptism?
That infants are just as much part of the covenant of grace as adults are.
Okay, good. Infants are just as much a part of the covenant of grace as adults. How would you go about proving that, showing that from the Bible? Allison.
The number 5 we have, Genesis 17, verse 7, that God works in the line of generations.
Good. Genesis 17, verse 7. All right. Great passage. God works in the line of generations. You know, partly when I ask you the question, it's not an easy one for you to answer because you've been brought up in a church that practices this. It's just part of your thinking. In a lot of ways, you wouldn't think of doing it any different way, right? It's hard to, maybe most of you probably have never been in a Baptist church. I remember being there one time, and that was the last time I went to that particular church where there was an adult baptism. So the drapes came back, and they got a big tank up behind the pulpit, and they filled it, and they got the big mural behind the way that shows the river coming down. It's like part of the river. I've heard of the churches that will take their whole congregation out to Lake Michigan, and people who are new members of the church will take them out and baptize them in Lake Michigan. Okay, that's never been part of your experience. So I realize your thinking, you're a lot of ways taught to think, no, it's infant baptism. But so Corey gets at the heart of it, Genesis 17, verse 7, but now those who practice believer baptism, you know what believer baptism is, right? That you have to make a confession in Christ, you have to accept Jesus Christ before you'll be baptized. Their argument is, okay, that's the Old Testament. That's not what you find in the New Testament. Okay, then what? Corey?
When Jesus was busy like talking, and then the disciples told the mothers to go away, when they were bringing their children to Jesus, Jesus rebuked the disciples and said that children are part of the kingdom of heaven.
Yeah, good. Right. Where's that passage? Oh, you hear it whenever the baptism form is read. One of those little parentheses in there. Allison?
Acts.
Nope.
Mark 10.
Mark 10. Yep. There's another one, though, is Acts. What's the passage? Alex?
Acts 2.
Verse?
39.
Great. Acts 2, verse 39. So, see, here's the benefit of reading the baptism form often. You get a healthy dose of why we baptism infants every time that form is read. Okay? Maybe we have a lot of parts of it memorized. I wonder sometimes if I could say it for a I've read it so often, but that's a good thing. All right? So Acts 2, verse 39, for the promise is unto you and to your children. So the promise of salvation to you and to your children and to all that are afar off. Mark 10, Jesus blessed the little children that were brought to him. And he said, for as such are the kingdom of heaven. Along with that, there's household baptism. Household baptism. Believer baptism today is not household baptism. Believer baptism is individual. Now they argue, well, we don't know that there are any children in those households. Well, okay, we don't know, but still it was households. And normally in households there's children. But it's household. Believer baptism is not household baptism. It's every person making a decision and then they get baptized. It's not what the New Testament teaches. It teaches household baptism. Now, let's just put a few main points here. First of all, baptism is a sign of the covenant, and God's covenant is a family covenant.
I'm just going to give you the main bullet points here. The first thing to understand is there is only one covenant of God, not two or more. Now, here's why that point's so important. It's so important because those who hold the believer baptism, usually they talk about there being two covenants of God. There's the Old Testament, New Testament. So there's the way God worked in the Old Testament. Children were circumcised. That doesn't carry over to the New Testament. That's a different covenant, different people of God. And here's what we see. No, there's only one covenant of God. All right, so just stick with me. There's one covenant of God. There's one covenant people of God. And what that means, there's one sign of the covenant that's shown in two ways. So there's only one people of God, and this covenant of God includes children. You know, the first point is probably not as important. The second one is this covenant of God includes children. Here's what we've seen, Genesis 17, verse 7, carry over the New Testament, Acts 2, verse 39, Mark 10, passages you guys brought up. And now, I said there's one sign of the covenant in two forms. That's what I mean here when I say baptism has come in the place of circumcision. There's the language of the baptism form. Baptism has come in the place of circumcision. And there's actually a passage that shows us that. It's not just a nice conclusion I come to. I'm not just making a jump here and saying that's the way it is. Colossians 2, verses 11 and 12. What Colossians 2, 11 and 12 shows is that baptism and circumcision mean the same thing, and therefore baptism has come in the place of circumcision. Colossians 2, 11 and 12. In whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. So what this verse says is in the Old Testament, when you had circumcision, that cutting away of the foreskin, it was a picture of something, putting off the body of the sins of the flesh. Okay, that's what we talked about, especially with the pollution of sin. 12, buried with him, that's with Christ, in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. There's a raising, a raising. Baptism is a picture of raising. Spiritual raising, what is that? Regeneration that we talked about, and the sanctification that follows from it. So the point is that circumcision, baptism mean the same thing. Why did God do away with circumcision? Why no more circumcision? Trevor?
It wasn't
the need for blood anymore because the blood of Christ came. And so baptism replaces circumcision. Here's what you have to understand about the argument of the Baptists. And this, I believe, is where it goes wrong. In the New Testament, you don't read about infant baptism, the sign of the covenant for infants, because it's a given. It's a given. In the Old Testament, when a boy was born into a family, 8 days later, he was circumcised. That began with Abraham. That's the way it was. The sign of the covenant was for infants. The implication is very clearly that unless that changes, the same is true in the New Testament. Because there's one covenant people of God, and there's one sign of the covenant. And so if that was to be changed, the New Testament, Jesus would have said it explicitly, but he doesn't. There's Acts 2, verse 39. There's Jesus' actions in Mark 10. There's households being baptized. All of it shows that the implication for the church in the New Testament is children receive this covenant sign. All right? Does that make sense? Okay. And so that's the way we read the whole Bible as one book all together as it teaches us about the one covenant of God. So this is just explaining that. I don't think you need to write that. Here's the point that Corey made earlier. In baptism, then we see how salvation is possible for an infant according to God's covenant. Just stating in a different way what Corey said earlier. We believe that children are also saved. They're part of the covenant of God.
And here's the problem with believer baptism. It basically says children are outside the kingdom. Children are outside the covenant. Children don't have salvation until they're older and they can believe in Jesus Christ. And so baptism tells us that infants are saved. That's Mark 10. They're held by Jesus and blessed by Jesus. It says that they're then saved by him. So we see in baptism how salvation is possible for infants. That's the point. Salvation's all of God and not of man.
And that's the beautiful truth that baptism declares every time it's administered to infants. It's not about them, it's not about us and what we do, it's all about God and what he does. Now, what I just said before you about the reason for infant baptism is a bit different than other Reformed churches, and that's important for you to know, and I just want to review it real quick. We've gone over this before. We looked at the covenant in Lesson 18. Remember the view of a conditional covenant? And we used the idea of a check, all right? So that, and this is what some Reformed churches believe today, and Presbyterian churches as well, that when a child is baptized, what happens is a check is written out in their name. Pay to the order of so-and-so. And the amount is eternal life. And it's as if when that child's baptized, they're given that check. But in order to get that eternal life, you have to do something with that check, right? And so that's their view of baptism. God's giving them that check. Now they've got to do something when they're older. What do you do with a check? Well, you can hang it on your wall. Look, I got this, but it doesn't do you any good. You know that if you get a check for working and you just keep it in your drawer or hang it on the wall, well, it may be nice, but that doesn't buy you gas for your car or pay for your cell phone. You can tear it up. And that's someone who is a covenant breaker. They've been given that check, but they don't want it. But you can also cash it. And that's what someone does when they believe in Jesus Christ. So that makes a conditional covenant. They have to do something to get what is pictured in that baptism. That's not why we baptize our infants. It's not, well, they'll eventually get it if they believe. No, we believe our children are saved. They're not all saved, but we believe our children are, because God works in the line of generations, and that's why we baptize.